Okay, just so everyone knows, again, I run the Truth Over Comfort podcast, but I haven't always been on kind of the market anarchist side. I'm a former Child Protective Services investigator. I was working in San Antonio, Texas, and I'm guilty of what many other Americans are guilty of, which is assuming that Child Protective Services, after committing atrocity after atrocity, has the best interests of children in mind after it's committed everything that it's done. I'm guilty of working for an agency that has hampered freedom throughout the United States and has caused thousands of families to live in fear. I'm guilty of working for an agency which has promoted the war on drugs rather than the war on child abuse. I'm also guilty of working for an agency that has kidnapped children, thrown them into foster care where they're 6 times more likely to die than if they stayed in an abusive household, and where those foster homes are incentivized to not only abuse, but also to drug the children. I'm guilty of working for Child Protective Services. At CPS, we did not help children, we hurt them. We did not help to protect society, we helped imprison it by getting the state's tentacles within the family structure, which is so important to civilization as a whole. As Judge Brian Lindsay put it, there is no agency that is seen fit to destroy families, so much so as our present family court system. I decided to work for the organization after a few real life altercations that I had in my own life with child abusers. As many of you kind of came to the ideas as far as child rights advocacy and the libertarian movement, I came from Stefan Molyneux's views in regards to the harmful effects of not only spanking, but negligence. After a few times where I actually stepped in on parents hitting their kids in public as if it was nothing, and then getting assaulted for trying to stop them, I decided I needed to get in the trenches to really stop child abuse head on, so I signed up for an organization which I believed at the time was made to do that. So I turned in my application into Child Protective Services. Now, you might imagine that an investigator would have quite a background in a number of things in order to prevent child abuse, right? I mean, they'd have maybe training in child development because they're supposed to be able to ask these children about abuse by their parents, whether that's sexual assault, negligence, or physical assault. You might imagine that they'd also have quite a bit of training in dispute resolution because they're supposed to be able to go to a parent's house and to be able to decipher fact from fiction while at the same time trying to not get assaulted. You might also assume that they'd have a lot of training in forensics because they're supposed to be able to tell if a bruise came from a punch, a spank, or fall. But according to Child Protective Services, how much training do you guys think they get? Well, zero is one of, which pretty much might as well be zero. So all you need is a bachelor's degree in literally anything, right? So there's one guy, he got a degree in jazz saxophone. And 2 months of training, 2 months, that's it. It's all you need to be the super investigator. Now, to kind of understand how Child Protective Services works, you need to kind of figure out how investigation works. Now, a phone call is made to Child Protective Services headquarters. Now, this person can be anonymous to CPS, or they can name themselves. But because of the bureaucratic incentives of Child Protective Services, the alleged perpetrator will never know the name of the person. Now, this abuse could be that the child is being left outside for maybe 3 or 4 hours to ride on a bike. It could be that the parents are using marijuana. It could be that the kid is too thin or too fat. But rarely, if ever, was it for actual physical or sexual abuse. Now, after they make the phone call, the supervisor gets the report. The report then goes to one of these well-trained investigators, right? So according to Child Protective Services, and according to the state, in every single state in the United States, the state owns the child. The parent does not. And because of this, an investigator can go out to a community center, he can go out to a public school, a church, or anywhere else to ask this child questions and even remove him before the parents even know it's coming. But the best place for CPS investigators, the best place they like to go, is public schools. Because, well, public schools is where they're already kidnapping those poor kids. So an investigator, they go out to a public school, they knock on the little kid's door. Imagine for a second, you're 5 years old, right? You're hanging out with this, you know, aggravated mass of other children your age in this artificial situation where you have a teacher who's telling you what to do all day. Now suddenly some big, I don't know, Hispanic guy like myself comes in and says, well, I'm gonna have to take you to another room, without really even saying what he's doing. He holds you by the hand, maybe, brings you to another room, usually some closed off place, maybe the principal's office, in which he says, I'm a Child Protective Services investigator, as if a five-year-old would know any of those words. Can I record this conversation? According to CPS, a five-year-old is capable of consent. Now from here, but he's not capable of, I don't know, being outside for 30 minutes. Now from here, the investigator tells the kid to sit down and starts recording the conversation, which sometimes gets to judges, sometimes it doesn't. Now the investigator will proceed to ask this kid softball questions. What's your favorite color? Who's your favorite teacher? Do you like going outside? These are supposed to ease the mind of the child. It never works. The kid is generally scared as hell. Then the hard-hitting questions come in, right? So, have you ever been forced to touch your father's penis? Where were you touched? If you see there's a leading question, and it's all about leading questions from Child Protective Services investigators. And just so you know, leading question means I'm already assuming something in the question. It's kind of like saying, how often do you hit your wife? There's already an assumption made. Now, this kid, again, generally scared, what he wants to do is try to get out of the situation as quickly as possible. And the best way to do that is by giving the answer yes, right? Yes, I'm being abused. Because this investigator does not want to go back to his supervisor and say, oh, no abuse is happening, we're not going to get any removal this week. And, you know, if you think about the authority figure in the situation, this state worker, when you create this tribalistic scenario that's occurring in these CPS offices, you're gonna get, again, issues with leading questions and authority figures in general. And I think the best example of this is, do you guys remember the satanic ritualistic abuse that was going on at daycares in the United States in the 90s? Exactly, alleged. So this is what happened. Investigators, these suave fellows, went to a daycare, a bunch of four-year-olds, and started asking them questions regarding satanic ritualistic abuse that was allegedly occurring. After a few questions, they got some interesting information. These daycare workers, they were grabbing brooms, and they were flying around the rooms, okay? They were taking babies, and they were throwing them in toilets and flushing the toilets down, right? Physically cannot happen. And then, here's the kicker, taking 12-inch machetes and shoving them into the rectum of babies. Take a guess how much physical evidence there was. Zero yet again. Now, with that zero physical evidence, what the investigators then did was, whenever they went to the press, what they decided to do was, instead of bringing up the most ridiculous stuff, like witches flying around, instead they said, oh, well, these daycare workers are molesting kids, and they're doing these ritualistic child sacrifices, maybe on occasion, but we're not sure. And with this shit evidence, they then were managed to throw a number of poor daycare workers into jail. Some of these people were there.
Can we hold questions or?
Oh, just hold for a second, I can get through. So some of these daycare workers ended up going to jail for 7 years for things they never did. And it wasn't until the FBI did a little investigation, you know, maybe asked some people some questions, that some of these daycare workers were let out. But many of these people are still under the sexual registered offenders and may never be able to get out, which kind of dooms their life. Now, you might think that this is a severe case, that I'm just being cynical in this case, but the thing is, this happens on a much more subtle level all the time. Because according to CPS, I can go to an uncle, right, who overheard from one of his friends, who overheard from another friend a year ago, that there was abuse occurring in some house. Again, this abuse can be marijuana use. So essentially what we're doing is we're considering evidence is the memory off the memory off the memory off the memory of someone else from a year ago. And that is considered evidence. Now there's this fun game that kids play that kind of shows you exactly why this is a terrible idea. Ever heard of the telephone game? So this tells you a lot about how religion was formed too. But you have one kid, he's told a message maybe 4 to 6 words. He says to another kid, to another kid, to another kid. And after about 2 minutes, the last message that is given out is obviously incorrect because you're reciting, reciting, reciting based off of your memory. And all of this happened in 2 minutes. Now with Child Protective Services, this is happening over maybe a year, maybe 5 years in specific cases actually. So what makes this even more messed up though is the biases that people throw into their stories. So let me give you a few examples of this happening in some of my own investigations. A mother and father are having a dispute, right? And according to the divorce court attorney, the divorce will not be able to go through for 6 to 7 months, which means that, let's say the mom and a boyfriend, she wants to leave the state, well, she can't. So what she does is she makes up a false allegation of sexual abuse by the father. And this can pretty much be considered ample evidence because according to Child Protective Services, you're guilty until proven innocent. And sexual assault is one of those things that's hard to disprove. In fact, a case I was dealing with in Asheville, North Carolina, this exact thing happened and it cost the dad $250,000 worth of court fees to get his kid back. Think about college tuition. Think about all the money that had to be spent. And in that rare case, he actually had the money to do so. In another case, there was a neighbor. He was having a dispute with another neighbor. And so what he did was he made an allegation of cocaine use, heroin selling, Mexican mafia ties. So when I always knew it was a bullshit case whenever they put Mexican mafia in there. I never got to meet one Mexican mafia guy in all of my cases, which was really sad. I just wanted to see what they were like. So, and in another case, we had teachers who would be mad at a kid. They didn't like the kid. He's a little shit, as the teachers would describe to me. And they would say, well, this child obviously has oppositional defiant disorder. So there's medical negligence because the child is not being dosed with drugs. There was a recent case, in fact, where a SWAT team went out to a parent's house to force the child to take psychiatric drugs because the parent didn't think it was necessary at the time. Now, when you think about the basis for the evidence that they have, the lack of training by Child Protective Service investigators, that's bad enough. But then you got to think about the bureaucratic incentives. Because usually what's brought up to me is that this is a case of a few bad apples, right? But I contest that the apple from which the tree that it fell, well, that truly was the root of all evil. And the root is the incentive structure by which Child Protective Services works. So I've heard some quotes, basically, that it's you get $4,000 to $6,000 per each child that is removed from the house, right? So that's not that doesn't go into the investigator's pocket, but the investigator gets raises every single year, and the only way that you keep going is if you get a certain amount of removals per year. Now, Child Protective Services only stays afloat if there's enough kids removed, but you also have foster homes, which have their own wicked incentives. Now, a foster home obviously only gets money if kids come in. Now, those kids, though, they get more money for every single child that has a disorder or disablement, right? Which kind of makes sense. So if you have a kid with a broken leg and he's coming in your house, you're going to have to bring him to the hospital on occasion. Maybe he's paralyzed. Maybe he has Down syndrome. But that's not the only kind of diagnosis that can get that foster home money. In fact, they're given more money for every single diagnosis a child has, and that could be considered a mental diagnosis. So put yourself in the shoes of a 5-year-old. You've just been removed from your community, your church, your school, your friends, your family. So you might have temperamental issues. You might not pay attention in class, for instance. You might yell at these foster care parents because you're most likely getting abused based off statistics. And you end up getting thrown into a state mental health facility because they're going to go ahead and double check what you have. Now, to us, to rational libertarian folks, we'd see that and go, well, this kid's in a terrible situation. We need to help him as well as we can. But according to that state health doc, That child has oppositional defiant disorder, bipolar disorder, insomnia, ADHD, schizophrenia. Okay? So that child is then placed on 5 different medications. I had kids who were 7 years old on over 7 psychiatric drugs with side effects ranging from suicidal behavior to weight gain, weight loss, and lack of brain and other organ development. Now, what's even more interesting is, as I brought up earlier, the majority of the cases of Child Protective Services where we actually got a removal were based off of something called negligence. In fact, over 85% of all cases end up because of negligence. But negligence, according to Child Protective Services, is the use of drugs. So we'd have a parent who admitted to using marijuana a year ago, and we could get a removal based off that. We were working hand in hand with the DEA, more so than the DEA could even handle, because we could simply go off of pure allegations. And so what was really happening here was we were sticking these kids in foster homes after their parents were being said they had drugs. And in those foster homes, children are 6 times more likely to die. They're 7 to 8 times more likely to be physically abused than if they stayed in a normal household. They are 3 times more likely to be put on psychiatric drugs than children in similar economic situations. They are 20% more likely to be homeless whenever they leave the house than children who have been sexually and physically assaulted. And they're more likely to have PTSD than war veterans, and they're less likely to recover from it. So what you guys might be thinking is, what can I do to try to prevent this from occurring? I mean, you guys, many of you are homeschooling. Child Protective Services considers that negligence. Many of you may use medicinal marijuana. Well, in cases of in Colorado, Washington, and California that I'm dealing with right now, in fact, in California, if you have a medicinal marijuana license, that is considered licensed to Child Protective Services for removal because they consider that negligence. So even if you are medically prescribed marijuana, that can still be considered enough evidence by CPS. So kind of the first thing to do in order to prevent Child Protective Services from being able to destroy your family is to realize what Child Protective Services is, which is a domestic terrorist group within the United States. There's very little things that are worse in it than any other agency. The second thing is to let all your friends know what Child Protective Services is, their true incentive structures, what they're likely to do, the questions they're likely to ask, which includes not only your friends, but maybe even your church pastor, people like that, because for some reason, people in churches like to call CPS on others. Never quite figured that one out, instead of maybe just talking to them. The third thing to do is tell your kids. So if your kids are still cooped up in public school, first, try to get them the hell out of there. But if you can't do that, let your kids know that CPS investigators are allowed to ask them questions, but they don't have to answer to anything. Tell your kids not to say a damn word. Now, if you've done this, at this point, Child Protective Services has very little evidence against you if you have a strong community basis. So, CPS will end up coming to your house. Now, according to the Fourth Amendment, they can't just barge in and walk in, although they do it on occasion. But let's say they're actually following the rules and they knock on your door. Well, the first thing is this. If you can afford a family court attorney, don't even bother answering the door. You don't need to talk to them whatsoever. But most people cannot afford a family court attorney. And in fact, never, ever take a court-appointed attorney. They have the same incentive structure as everyone else does as far as Family Protective Services is concerned. So they're going to knock on your door. You open up. The first thing to do is to start recording the conversation, whether through video or audio. Now, they're going to ask you can I come into your house? To which you say no. You do not allow a CPS investigator in your house ever. They can see a few dirty pans and they can consider that enough evidence to get a removal because it's considered an unlivable condition. If they see, I don't know, maybe a knife out of place, well, you could have been physically assaulting your child with a knife. So don't let them in your house. Next, they're gonna ask you a series of questions on domestic violence, on your past history with Child Protective Services, if you've ever been abused. If you admit that you've ever been abused as a child. That could be considered evidence that you could possibly end up abusing your kid in the future. So you're not a fit parent. If you admit that you have ever been assaulted by, say, your husband, even if he's been outside of the house for 2 years, that's considered evidence that you're an unfit parent. So never admit to any kind of domestic violence. I'm sorry if you're going through that, but they're not your fucking therapist. They aren't good people. They're also going to ask you a few questions in regards to abuse. Now, if you are physically abusing your kid, I don't really want to help you figure out other things in your own life to be able to remedy that situation. The main things here, though, are simply do not admit to anything and don't sign any paperwork whatsoever. Now, if the allegation is regarding drug use, what they can get is a warrant. Now, they can't get in the warrant if it's an anonymous report, but they can if it is not an anonymous report. Now, there's a few different types of drug tests that they do. One of the ones they like doing, though, immediately is something called an oral swab drug test. Now, if you're on oxycodone, benzos, or anything else, you're definitely not going to want to take this test because you're going to test positive for those particular drugs. And even if you have a prescription, they can say that you were overusing those barbiturates. But as far as illegal narcotics are concerned, as long as you have not consumed any drugs from 48 hours ago, so let's say it's Monday and you were taking bong rips and snorting cocaine off hookers on Friday, you're still going to pass it. So there's a risk there, but definitely don't ever admit to any drug use to this investigator. Now, the other form of drug test that they might be able to get if you end up in court is a urine sample. You can kind of pass those things, but I'm not going to go too much into that because that's my specialty, but I know people who have been on a number of drugs and been able to pass those things with a little bit of vitamin B, creatine, and a whole lot of water. Now, if you've done everything correctly, hopefully you don't end up in court. If you do end up in court, you're going to need a family court attorney because, one, the law is so dense that even family court attorneys have a hard time being able to get through it. Secondly, I've seen court judges actually laugh at parents because of the way that they're dressed or the way that they're acting. They do not have an incentive to protect the family whatsoever because the judges in the particular case, the prosecutor, the court-appointed attorney, CPS, APS actually also, all have the exact same incentives to destroy the family structure. Adult Protective Services, and in North Carolina, it's called DSS, right? Isn't that there?
Department of Social Services.
Yeah, DSS, right, okay. I mean, it goes under a lot of acronyms, but they're all pretty much doing the same sleazy stuff. Now, at Child Protective Services, I wouldn't say that the people I was working with were volitionally evil, but they were some of the worst human beings I've ever met in my entire life. And I honestly rather hang out with child abusers than some of the people that I met at CPS. I've heard them make jokes about families because the mom was crying too much after a child was taken away. I've heard prosecuting attorneys make jokes with judges. I've seen a judge check his email during a case because there wasn't a real defense attorney there, so he wasn't really even paying attention, and he ended up getting a full legal removal of the children in this particular case, and that was a marijuana case that I was dealing with at the time. Right now, there are 250,000 children under CPS care in the United States, and that number is growing, not dropping. CPS is continuing to get more and more money. Now, another thing, though, with these CPS investigators is that they have a pseudo-hero personality disorder. Added to the DSM. I'm sure it's somewhere in there. But as far as I'm concerned, the majority of these investigators thought that they were heroes, that they were protecting people. Although I would not say that they had the best intent whenever they joined, because I knew a lot of investigators who simply made it clear they wanted some money and they knew this was a secure job. In fact, I was at supervisor meetings where they would tell us, well, if you quit this agency, you know everywhere else pays less. And every single year, you're given more and more money. So you can end up making $72,000 a year as an investigator, working 8 hours a day, but everyone thinks that you're overworked. which is the same thing that goes to public school teachers, cops, and a number of other government officials. So society makes excuses for these people on a constant basis, except for the people who have actually met CPS investigators. Now, whenever I quit the agency, I was told by a number of investigators, you know, not everyone is made for this. Not everyone has the characteristics to be a good investigator. And they were right. I really don't like doing evil shit. I don't like kidnapping people. Not a big fan. I'm not a big fan of sitting down and listening to authority figures without ever questioning anything whatsoever. I'm not a big fan of the government as a whole. So whenever they told me I wasn't cut to be an investigator, I took that as a compliment. And this message is really important for activists. I know there's a particular case in Austin that occurred within this last year of a marijuana activist whose child was removed and the child died in 2 weeks in foster care. This has happened over and over again. In fact, I waited till I moved out of Texas to come out and say that I used to work for CPS. There are no other investigators out there coming out and putting out their name, admitting the fact of what's going on in this agency. And though it may be true, although I don't really buy it, that they had the best of intentions, the road to hell is paved with good intentions. Any questions?
I was wondering about the training that you said, that two months.
Yeah.
What exactly does it cover? Because when you were talking about the story of they might come into the whole into the public school and take their stuff, I mean, what does that training cover?
Okay, so essentially, you go over some of the laws as far as that's concerned, like, oh, don't do this. But for the most part, what they're really doing is they're prepping you to believe that everyone is a potential abuser. So it's basically, you know, it's just pure propaganda for those whole 2 months. They usually show you a lot of pictures of people who have been abused, you know, just a lot of pictures of like dead babies, things like that. So that you create a cult of personality within the agency to believe that everyone is a terrible human being outside of you. Of course, I've known investigators who smoked marijuana, who abused their own kids, who were absolutely negligent, and then they busted parents for doing those exact same things.
It's a case I'm sure you're familiar with in, I think it was Union County, you know, here in North Carolina, back in October, I think, where it was a CPS supervisor who had custody of a child and had them handcuffed to the front porch with a dead chicken around their neck, and it was 40 degrees outside.
That was a couple of weeks ago.
Well, it was a couple months ago.
Well, that's crazy. Jesus. You know, oh, and as far as dealing with this kind of situation, I know Michael's going to be giving a speech soon in regards to a stateless society and how to deal with a number of different issues. There's this thing in libertarianism that I'm really, really sick of, which is this idea is, as long as they're not doing anything to me, it doesn't matter to me. We need to work as a community to try to get rid of child abuse. We shouldn't be just sitting around in our own house while ignoring the catastrophes that are occurring out there. Child abuse is real, but asking a libertarian how we're going to replace child protective services is like asking a libertarian how we're going to replace the DEA. We're not going to, because we don't feel like kidnapping kids. We want to actually stop this. And this sense of community has been completely rooted out by child protective services and every other state agencies. There were cases in the middle of the ghetto while I was in San Antonio where a girl, about 13, was wrapped up in a on a fence, and her dad beat her with an extension cord in front of everyone, and no one did anything. And this had occurred over a three-month span. He was doing this a few times a week, and no one said a damn thing until someone finally called CPS. And that was one of those rare cases where I actually did something. You know, there were occasions. But in even that particular case, we ended up sticking to her foster home, where she was sexually assaulted. This is not something that we should be okay with. Children are not the property of parents to the point where they can just beat them mercilessly because they're their parent.
Well, you said something about you're not going to replace CPS
Yeah. Yeah, and I think in those particularly terrible situations, I wouldn't blame anyone for doing so. As far as how arbitration and all that would work, I'm not exactly sure. I don't really try to make any guesses about the future. I didn't know the iPhone was going to come out 20 years ago, you know, so not really sure.
Are there some other resources you'd recommend for more information
on? Yeah, yeah. Fightcps.com. They are an amazing website. Fightcps.com. I also run a Facebook group called Child Protective Services Victim Support. And those two places should really be able to help. FightCPS is a really great forum and things like that where people can discuss the issues they're having. They also have a really good list of family court attorneys that have been trained to deal with Child Protective Services. The statistics on child welfare, as far as foster care is concerned, that's actually from their government's own website, childwelfare.gov. There was the 7-8 times more likely to be abused was a British agency that came into the United States and studied foster care. It was like a longitudinal study over the course of like 20 or 30 years.
She said placeholder diagnosis.
Okay. Well, like the medical agency that they're brought to. I mean, that's where the doctor makes that diagnosis. And then after you turn 18, I mean, there is a reason why so many of them end up homeless because they didn't really know what to do anyway. So I'm not sure on that. Okay, we can talk later. And all right, thank you very much. Oh, we got one more question. Okay, fair enough. So it depends on the state. It's a state-by-state situation as to whether or not you have to register your kid. But in particular cases, if people believe your child's not being educated, there was the Mormon church where there was a group of different homeschoolers and everyone was calling CPS on them, even though the kids were able to read at the age of 6. So they made them do a bunch of standardized tests and a bunch of other stuff, even though those were not required by law. So, yeah, it's really case by case. And again, I really emphasize to go to fightcps.com to find any more.
Do they have state breakdowns?
They have state breakdowns and everything else. Those are hard working people. Most of them are people that had to deal with Child Protective Services and now have a vengeance against them to try to help out other people.
Okay, thanks, Carlos. Okay, we are gonna, I guess we'll jump right into Mike Shanklin's talk, that's up next. After that, we will have a break in the schedule for lunch, and we don't have a food vendor here yet, they'll be coming for dinner, and the meals after that through the weekend. So, I guess, you know, do your own thing for lunch. The next talk is on the schedule, it says 1 p.m., that's Albert. But Albert, if it's okay with you, I think we might push that off to like 1:15, just to give people a few extra minutes to get back from lunch. So, all right, so next talk, how a free society might operate. Mike Shanklin. Mike holds an MBA from Campbell University, where he founded the Campbell Liberty Club.